this week on Stakelbeck on Terror. They're two leading voices in the fight against the Islamization of the West. Robert Spencer and Pamela Geller are here to discuss Islamic honor killings in America, Sharia law in your backyard, and the latest on the Ground Zero mega mosque. Plus, a sneak peek at Spencer's controversial new book, Did Muhammad Exist?
There was no Muhammad and there was no Quran. The people who were conquered, when they write about what happens, they never mention that the conquerors came with a new religion or a new prophet or a new holy book.
The politically correct need not apply. Let's go to work.
And welcome to Stakelbeck on Terror. I'm joined today by two leaders of the counter-jihad movement. Robert Spencer is the founder of jihadwatch.org and author of the provocative new book, Did Muhammad Exist? And Pamela Geller is the founder of the Essential Atlas Shrugs blog, and she's the author of the must-read book, Stop the Islamization of America, A Practical Guide to the Resistance. Welcome.
Thanks for having us.
Yeah, great to have you both here. I called you the dynamic duo before we started rolling on the show, so it's great to have you together talking about these issues. And I want to start about something you collaborated on just last month in late April, guys. There was a conference in Dearborn, Michigan, or as we call it on this show, Dearbornistan, to shine a light on really the growing epidemic of honor killings in America. Robert, we'll start with you. Tell us about that conference and kind of the subject matter there.
Well, what we called this, and this was Pamela's idea to call this the Jessica Mokhtad Human Rights Conference on Honor Killing. Jessica Mokhtad was a young girl, a Muslim girl, in the Dearborn area, in Warren, actually, who was murdered by her stepfather for refusing to follow Islamic mores. And the funny thing about it is that this was widely reported as an honor killing, which, as you know, never happens in the mainstream media. It was widely reported that she was killed for not following Islam. And so it seemed like a natural thing to name this conference in her honor to show that we, at least, were not going to allow the dehumanization and the obliteration of the memories of these girls, and we were going to stand up and say no more of this practice. We're not going to allow this in the United States.
And you held it in the belly of the beast, really, Dearborn, largest Arab American population.
Well, this is Pamela's particular genius in this fight is being able to put the Islamic supremacists on the defensive. Yeah. And it was her idea, actually, to put it in Dearborn after her own conference was canceled under pressure from the Hamas-linked Council on American Islamic Relations.
Where was it in
Sugarland, Texas, and I was there to speak, and the very day that I got in, it was canceled because of pressure by thugs and bullies. And what happened was, what the Hyatt did not anticipate was the blowback that was that they received by people that were outraged that my speech was canceled. They brought me down. It wasn't my event. I had been brought down to speak. Interestingly enough, I mean, people were selling their stock. That's how viral it went, that the Hyatt had canceled us. Now, they had gotten back to me. They apologized. Yeah. Props to the Hyatt. They apologized. Yeah. They said, we'll give you space in Sugarland. I said, well, why do I need space in Sugarland? I just spoke there. The beauty was that it got so much publicity, the cancellation, where I was supposed to speak to about 150. I wound up speaking to about 400.
Wow.
So, the Lord works in mysterious ways.
Yeah.
And they said, we'll give you space in Sugarland. I said, well, I just spoke there. They said, we'll give you space anywhere in America. I said, anywhere?
Yeah.
They said, yeah. I said, okay, Dearborn.
Yeah. And what was the response, Pam, in Dearborn to the conference you held?
Well, it was important that Jessica Mokhtad be remembered, because this is what we see time and time again, that these girls, their murders are the culmination of a life lived in abject terror. Their homes are homemade concentration camps. They lead two separate lives. They lead a Western life in school. You'll see they're usually very good in school. They go out for tennis and AP classes and, you know, like Amina and Sarah Saeed.
Sure.
And then at home, they live as, subjugated Muslim girls.
Right. They're Western in their daily life, but then at home,
they're home,
in Arabia.
Yes, and they are subjugated, they are oppressed, they are many times beaten. The final act of control is, of course, as you know, the honor killing. So it was on the anniversary of Jessica Mokhtad's honor murder that we held the conference. Now, to your question, how was it received? There was immediate blowback that we were using her name. by the family which I consider to be co-conspirators in her murder, by the family that, because not only was the stepfather's household treacherous, but according to her dear friend Darwin Giles, her father's household was also treacherous in that he wanted her to live under Islamic tradition. He wanted her to wear the hijab
in America.
And it's interesting to me that every picture that's released by the family, she's wearing the hijab, she's wearing the head covering, when in fact she was rebelling against that, and she didn't want to. She did not want to wear the hijab.
Guys, can I ask you something, both of you? This is becoming a more and more pressing issue. This is happening with greater frequency, these honor killings in America.
Oh, yes.
Where are the feminists on this issue? Can someone answer that?
Well, the feminists are married to their dogma. The feminists, first of all, you can't ask me because I'm so not a feminist. I'm a male chauvinist, if you must know. And listen, feminism is rooted in Lenin Marxist dogma. It's like saying, okay, empower me, but I want the government to pay for it. Hello. And they are very much part of the leftist Islamic alliance. Anytime you ask them for a comment on honor killing, and this is not just in America, but this is in the UK, this is in Canada, they'll always say, oh, speak to the Islamic groups on that. And this is part of the problem that we see here in America with the services for girls that are non-existent, because many times these shelters, when these girls run away or they go to the police, what do the police do? They return them to this household, which eventually is going to lead to their deaths if they don't get away and run away. And it's not just merely running away from a family member, like if you're being abused by your spouse, a woman tries to get away from the husband. You have to get away from not only your family, but your mosque and your community. It's an incredibly difficult journey, and there's no network, and this is what Robert and I seek to achieve, not only establish safe houses, but they need an enormous intellectual support system.
Another cause that you guys have really championed and been on the forefront was the fight against the Ground Zero mega mosque. Robert, what's the latest? We haven't heard a lot lately.
The great news, Erick, is there is no latest. Nothing's happening. I mean, actually, I guess the very latest is that the Imam Rauf, who used to be the front man for this whole project, is coming out with a new book, and he's being whitewashed everywhere, and
he's a great moderate.
Yeah, his ties to the Muslim Brotherhood, his ties to the jihad flotilla that tried to attack Israel, his so many unsavory ties, his refusal to denounce Hamas and all that is being whitewashed yet again. Bill O'Reilly was fawning all over him the other night on Fox, and this is obviously an attempt to resuscitate this whole project. But what they've essentially done is they declared victory and got out. What we were objecting to was the building of a triumphal mosque, and there are thousands of precedents for the building of triumphal mosques.
It's a victory arch.
Yeah, the site of jihad attacks.
Sure.
Or the appropriation of the holy sites of conquered people and building of mosques there. The Temple Mount is the most notorious example. Yeah. But what we saw there was we were objecting to the projected 16-story mega mosque that they were going to build at Ground Zero, on Ground Zero, in the Burlington Coat Factory building, or tear down the Burlington Coat Factory building that was severely damaged, and it was therefore part of Ground Zero. It was the landing gear from one of the planes flew into the roof of this building, and it lay vacant for years until Muslims started to pray there and use it as a mosque. But they were going to tear down that building and build this triumphal structure. Now, they were actually going to start. The initial reports from Daisy Khan, Farhat Khan, the wife of the Imam Rauf, were that they were going to break ground on the new building on September 11th, 2011, to add insult to injury, on the 10th anniversary of the attack.
Yeah.
And they didn't. They have declared their community center open in that same half-abandoned, severely damaged Burlington Coat Factory building. And all these people contacted us and said, well, what do you think now that the community center is open? Well, I think we won, because they didn't build their big mega mosque that they had initially planned to build.
Even though President Obama supported it, by the way.
Yeah.
So, guys, we're talking about honor killings in America. We're talking about triumphal mega mosques in America. And, Pam, that's why I think your book is so important. Stop the Islamization of America, A Practical Guide to the Resistance. Give us some ways we can stop this creeping Sharia in America.
Well, we can continue on the Ground Zero Mosque. I think it's important that your viewers know that despite overwhelming support by the elite, by the cultural elite, by the media elite, by the political elite, I mean, you had the president at the iftar dinner come out in support of the Ground Zero Mosque. You had a mayor of New York City, Mayor Bloomberg, come out and say, if we don't let them build it, the terrorists will win. I mean, you can't make this stuff up. And despite NBC News naming Sharif Al-Gamal, who was the developer, NBC Man of the Year. And Imam Raouf was nominated as Time Magazine's Man of the Year.
Yes,
but my point in this is that despite this overwhelming tsunami, because they wanted this mosque to be built, it was the people. It was the people that came to our first protest, June 6th, D-Day, September 11th, who overwhelmingly supported politicians who would speak out. I mean, look what happened to Sarah Palin. She tweeted one thing, that a mosque stabs at the heart, and she was eviscerated by the media. This book teaches you how to fight mosques in your neighborhood where they try and build, mega mosques on small, quiet residential streets, the mosquing of the public school where they're putting aside prayer spaces for Muslim children and instituting Islamic curriculums, not Islamic curriculums that teaches about 1,400 years of 270 million victims of jihadi wars, land appropriations, cultural annihilations, and enslavements, but it's dawah. You're proselytizing to school children. Do they have a Christian curriculum in public schools? Do they have a Jewish or Hindu curriculum in public schools? The masking of the workplace, how to recognize these things and how to stand up and how to fight back.
Well, we got to leave it there. Pam Geller, thanks so much for joining us. The book is called Stop the Islamization of America, A Practical Guide to the Resistance. It is a must read. Pam, we'll have you back soon.
Thank you.
Robert, you're going to hang out after the commercial. We're going to talk more about your book, Did Muhammad Exist? Coming up, much more. Stay tuned. And welcome back. We're talking to Robert Spencer, director of jihadwatch.org and author of, I don't know, Robert, they say this book is too hot for TV. I don't know, man. Did Muhammad Exist? An Inquiry into Islam's Obscure Origins. The title alone grabs you, and it's a must read. Tell us why you wrote it.
Well, I wanted to know. And so I started to investigate. Actually, in all seriousness, I wrote a biography of Muhammad, a book called The Truth About Muhammad in 2006.
Which is also excellent, yes.
And that is an attempt to explain to non-Muslims what the earliest Islamic sources say that Muhammad said and did.
Sure.
And as I was investigating those, I started to see, well, these don't really have a whole lot of historical value. These are very late. The first biography of Muhammad comes out over 125 years after he died. And that's the first one. And before that, there's just a yawning absence. There's little to nothing about him in Islamic tradition. And so I put a note in The Truth About Muhammad that the historical value of all these things was suspect, and it was always something that I wanted to follow up on.
So for 125 years, Robert, after his death in 632, there was no mention of specifically of Muhammad in any...
When you talk about the 125 years, especially the last half of that, the last 60, there are mentions of him, but they are very sparse and vague and nonspecific, and some of them don't correspond to what we know from Islamic tradition at all, the things that he just did not do. But even more than that, the first 60 years of that, I'm talking about the period of the great Arab conquests from the 630s to the 690s, when they conquered all of the Middle East and North Africa and Persia.
Peacefully.
Yes,
we know
of course.
Better.
Yes.
But go
ahead. By the sheer compelling power of the Quran.
Yes.
And the words of Muhammad.
And a few
actually,
swords.
That's the whole point. There was no Muhammad and there was no Quran. The people who were conquered, when they write about what happens, they never mention that the conquerors came with a new religion or a new prophet or a new holy book, and they never call them Muslims. And the conquerors, in their own records, they never mention that they have a new religion or Muhammad or a holy book. And they never, in the coins they issued or in the inscriptions that they made on public buildings, there's never a single syllable about Muhammad or Islam or the Quran, which is supposed to be the driving force for all those conquests.
Yeah. And this just fascinates me, Robert, because number one, because you are a great researcher. You've been doing this for three decades, the better part of three decades, you living and breathing Islam.
Allahu Akbar.
And counter jihad.
Yes, you're right. I'm against it. Yes.
I should say not living and breathing. Yes, exactly. But the other thing that fascinates me about this is we've had so many historical inquiries into the Bible, the Old and New Testament, the existence of Jesus, the existence of Moses. This, as far as I know, is the first real serious effort to dig down and kind of get into the real origins of Islam and its prophet.
Well, It's the first that is designed to reach a wide audience. There are scholars, some great and courageous scholars, some of whom labor under pseudonyms because of the threats that they're under for doing this. But actually, in this book, I am working from the labors of a very small group of largely unheralded scholars who've been working in this field.
Well, Robert, I've got to stop you there. We're going to commercial, but coming up, much more with Robert Spencer talking about his book, Did Muhammad Exist? Don't move. And welcome back. We're talking to Robert Spencer about his new book, Did Muhammad Exist? And Robert, one of the things that really caught my attention in the book is what the earliest Christian and Jewish records say about the Islamic conquerors. Tell us about some of that.
Well, the funny thing is that they, in the first place, never call them Islamic conquerors. Yeah. They say the Saracens came and laid waste, yeah, or the Hagarenes, or the Ishmaelites, or the Muhajirun, but they never call them Muslims. They never say that they came with a religion that they said was superior to the religion that we have, and they never came with, they never mention a book or a prophet. And this is an extraordinary silence when you consider that this is supposed to be the motivating force for why they're conquering in the first place.
So where did it come from, the whole Islamic narrative? Muhammad is their prophet, the Quran is their law.
The whole thing was built in the starting in the 690s and accelerating in the 700s, and especially in the 800s when we start to get all the biographical material about Muhammad. Yeah. But it started in the latter part of the 7th century and especially in the 8th among the Arab leaders who had amassed this empire. And in those days, there were two great powers in the world, the Byzantine Empire and the Persian Empire. Mm-hmm. And both were multinational, multi-ethnic empires that were held together by a common religion. Mm-hmm. The Byzantines were Christians and the Persians were Zoroastrians. Mm-hmm. The Arabs came out of Arabia and conquered all this huge expanse of territory. And some of them were vague Abrahamic monotheists. Some of them were Christians of various kinds. Some of them were pagans and polytheists. And the Arab leaders developed Islam in order to give their empire a unifying force. And this is one of the reasons why Islam is political, belligerent, authoritarian, supremacist, violent, intransigent, and intolerant, because it was designed to strengthen an empire and to be a political force for cohesion. It was political first and religious only secondarily.
Yeah, and arguably it's the same way today as well.
Precisely.
Yeah. What's been the response to this book? Very provocative, of course. Like I said jokingly, too hot for TV, but I'd imagine a lot of people are running away from this book right now.
Well, it is too hot for TV, Erick. You're the only one who has the courage to
deal
with this on TV.
We're honored to have you on, anytime.
And I appreciate that. Most people in the so-called conservative media are afraid to deal with it, and I think that the leftists and the Islamic supremacists are hoping that if they ignore it, it'll just go away. There was one very funny Muslim writer for a site online called Religion Dispatches who roundly condemned the book and said it didn't make any sense and it was terrible, and he did it 2 weeks before the book came out. He actually hadn't seen the book. He was working from the press release.
Yeah.
And the press release was enough
right
for him.
How is this going to affect the discourse? Do you think it will affect the discourse? I know you hope it does. But do you think, look, that this will possibly affect the conversation about Islam and what we're up against right
now? I have every confidence that it will, Erick. I mean, there's such a debate right now about whether Islam is political or religious. The anti-Sharia laws being considered in various states are being struck down by liberal activist judges on the grounds that Islam is purely religious and not political.
Sure.
And so I'm saying Islam was from the beginning political and not religious, and I'm hoping that that will have a great impact. Also, we are in the process of translating this book into Arabic. It's going to be made available as a free PDF online everywhere we can put it, and we're hoping to effect a tremendous transformation in the Islamic world itself.
Yeah. What has been the Muslim response, if any? I know you mentioned the one critic.
Fury and contempt.
Yeah.
But nobody has dealt with the arguments. I actually had a very interesting debate on the Aramaic Broadcast Network, which is absat.com, by satellite to the Islamic world and online in America. And I debated, along with David Wood, Anjum Chowdhury and Omar Bakri, two jihad leaders.
We've had Chowdhury on the show. Yes.
Yeah. And they said, of course Muhammad existed. It's in the Quran.
Yes.
And that was the extent of their engagement.
If it's in the Quran, it must be true.
There you go.
Although it's interesting because Jerusalem is never mentioned in the Quran.
Not once.
Yet
that's right.
They say that Jerusalem is their third holiest city. Pretty interesting.
That's all.
Although it's mentioned hundreds of times in the Bible, both books.
Yes, it's in the Hadith. Jerusalem is mentioned, but the Hadith is the traditions of Muhammad's words and deeds, as we have been discussing. They don't come around till the 9th century.
Yeah.
Well over 100, 150, sometimes 200 years after Muhammad is supposed to have lived, suddenly we know all about what Muhammad said and did. It's legendary material that has no more value than the stories of Robin Hood and Friar Tuck and the Merry Men.
Wow, well, I think I know where you stand, but coming up, we're going to talk more to Robert Spencer. We're going to wrap it up with Robert, and we're going to ask him. Okay, he's written the book. What's his take? Did Muhammad exist? That's coming up. Stay tuned.
Do you want to know the truth about the jihadist in your backyard? Then be sure to pick up my book, The Terrorist Next Door, How the Government is Deceiving You About the Islamist Threat. Available wherever books are sold from coast to coast.
And welcome back. We're wrapping up with the author of Did Muhammad Exist? And Robert, what's your take, man? After all this research, painstaking, did Muhammad exist?
No. As the prophet of Islam, as the man who was the warlord and the pedophile and all these different things that we are so familiar with after dealing with Islamic terror, there's just no record of him at the time when it would have clearly been there if it had existed, if he had existed.
And this is after meticulous research, and you've been doing this for three decades. Wow. This is fascinating stuff. I recommend the book to everyone. Did Muhammad Exist? An Inquiry into Islam's Obscure Origins. Robert Spencer, he's also the director of jihadwatch.org. And don't forget Pam Geller's book, Stop the Islamization of America, A Practical Guide to the Resistance. Well, that's all for this week. Until next time, from Stakelbeck on Terror, take care. God bless.